Continuing to watch live images come in from the Gaza. This is 10:23 p.m. Obviously, it's hours later there, and nightfall has been with them for many hours, and there have been a lot of incursions. Our correspondent there, Leland Vittert, mentioned all of the sorties that the Israeli Air Force are flying in, and they've hit a lot of targets today. The question is, what happens with ground troops? And bigger picture, how does Egypt react? Let's bring in Mike Barrett, former intelligence officer for the Office of the Secretary of Defense, currently the CEO of the D.C. consulting firm Diligent Innovations. Mike, good of you. Thank you.
Afternoon, Shep.
Let's start with these ground troops. It's one thing to mass them. It's another thing to send them.
It is, but I mean, you're talking about 30,000 reservists have reportedly called up. And again, as you just reported, the missile that was sent towards Tel Aviv, that's a red line for Israel. So I think what we're going to see here is a dramatic escalation. Frankly, just in the last few hours, it's gotten a lot worse. I would have said this would be a small flare-up over in a couple days, but it looks to me now like it's going to be much more significant.
Yep, condemnation has come from the Egyptians, and so much instability there, and frankly, a lot of fears.
Yeah, that's right. So the big player in the region has always been Egypt. Ever since the Camp David Accords in 1979, the U.S. has been essentially bankrolling some peace between Egypt and Israel. But I think that, you know, obviously with the Arab Spring and all the events that have happened last year, now the Muslim Brotherhood in charge in Egypt, that equation has changed dramatically. The other player we have to keep an eye on is Turkey. Israel and Turkey used to have very close military-to-military relations, but that's faded in the last few years as well. So we really are seeing, you know, coming to fruition of this new chessboard in the Middle East, if you will. And I think it's going to, you know, it's going to be very dangerous as people try to figure out who are the players, what are their motivations, what are their red lines, what are their strategies. I think you're going to see a lot of permissive activity by the Egyptians. They're going to allow weapons to flow in, as they've been doing with Syria as well. One of the things we have to be worried about is, what are they going to do to shipping through the Suez Canal? Are there going to be some implications there for the U.S. and for global trade? So there's any number of issues that are significant coming to the fore, and then, frankly, this is uncharted territory.
The last thing the Israelis want to do, and they've made this clear over the years, ever since their occupation of Gaza, is to occupy it again. That said, once you get in there, you have to kind of own the thing. Where does the United States stand on all of this at the moment?
Well, I don't think you're going to see any daylight between Israel and the U.S. on this. Even if just for base political domestic reasons, the administration can't afford, even coming off the heels of an election victory, they can't possibly afford to allow any kind of bipartisan or, you know, any kind of divide based on partisan maneuvers and bickering. So I think the U.S. is going to stand very firmly by Israel in providing weapons, as we historically have done, and resupplying them and things like that. But again, and of course, we have a very active intelligence sharing program. But you start to look also at, you know, the broader escalation of this. Is this a way for Israel to sort of test out their Iron Dome system and the 300 missiles that have been launched at them just in the last couple of days? What does that mean and portend in terms of their potential strike against Iran and sort of checking out their weapons versus the, you know, the Hamas and the Egyptian and potential Iranian responses?
Yep, there's that. History tells us that the Israelis don't mess around. If we're following the history book on how this sort of thing works, going back to the conflict with Lebanon and Hezbollah just a few years ago, first you soften up the targets, the Air Force is in there doing that, knocking out their weapons and the rest. Normally, right on the heels of that, with history as our guide, Israel moves.
Yeah, you're absolutely right about that. And I think this is one of those situations where, again, there's a lot of uncertainty in the region, and perhaps Israel looked at it strategically and said, you know what, we need to throw the first punch. We want to get in there, we want to do a lot of damage, take out the weapon stockpiles, take out everything we know where it is. And that's why you see so many sorties going in and bombing the missiles and things like that. I do think it's important for people to realize if they've launched 300-some rockets and they've only killed three people, that does show you that Hamas is not particularly capable. They can cause a lot of concern, but they're not very good at targeting these weapons. But of course, again, Iran or Egypt may provide better weapons in the future.
He's right about that, Mike Barrett.